This is the Global Control of Decentralized Mesos Clusters talk. I'm Daniel Giribet from a company called Shipstead, which for those who don't know us, I'll just give you a very brief introduction later. And I work in the Products and Technology Division within the infrastructure team. And yeah, we like Mesos a lot. And it's quite exciting to be at MesosCon for the first time for us, at least. Oh, cool. So as I said, I'll provide a bit of context about who we are, because that explains the job, the work we've been doing, and hopefully that will make things a bit clearer. So Shipstead is a media group. The base of the media group is based in Oslo, in Norway. But it's an international company, and it has around 7,000 employees distributed amongst 31 countries. And we do all sorts of stuff related to online marketplaces, selling and buying stuff from jobs to cars to clothes to all sorts of goodies. And we also have media divisions that do newspapers, news, etc. And yeah, that's pretty cool. And we have around 200 million users, more or less, give or take a few million. And that's, what's that, half of the United States population? So that's a pretty big figure. Because, you know, and this is aggregating all the people from these 31 countries. So it's pretty big user base that seem to enjoy our products. And I'll just give you a few examples. That's fin.no, which is the largest marketplace in Norway and has like 2.4 million users, I think, from memory. And in there, you can buy and sell all sort of stuff. And yeah, it's in Norwegian, but it's pretty cool. And yeah, we have all sorts of websites and services like that across the world in those 31 countries I mentioned. And actually, we are growing, so we probably have even more countries as we speak. And that's another example, which is Leboncoin in France, has a few million users as well. And it's, I think, the top five website on France, if not the top third. That's also quite difficult figures, but it's the biggest marketplace in France by a wide stretch. And for instance, I don't know if the Oldsmobile Cutlass Supreme 1969 Cabrio sold yet, but even if anyone fancies it, it's only 21,000 euros. It's in France. You have to pick it there, but it's actually quite a good deal. So there you go. And this is, for instance, VG. This is a media house. It's the largest kind of newspaper, media online site in Norway as well. It's quite popular. And yeah, seems to be, so this is from this morning, and seems to be like something about a fjord. So that's pretty big news, apparently. So, and we have many sites like this across the world, which makes adds up to this 200 million plus users we have. And most of them are paying customers, so that's pretty cool. And this creates unique challenges, because it's different from other shops that have like just a global presence. We have a global presence as well, but with different local country sites, etc. And this means that we have teams on the ground on those countries that do a very good job, and this is, you know, they're awesome. Some of them are in this room already. How are you? And this is pretty cool. But we work in the infrastructure team, which we have the remit of thinking a bit more globally. So helping out the guys on the ground, we're seeing if we can deliver stuff globally on a world scale that will help them out carry their mission, which is enable people to sell and buy stuff and get informed on news. And this actually is a picture of the countries we are in. So there's still many missing spots, but we're working very hard to fill them in. But that's quite an impressive list for countries. And for an European, I cannot name all of them, so, but you know, there's quite a few. And that it's a large amount of people and markets we're targeting, and we're actually dealing with every day. And we have teams on these countries that I only put a few spots. There will be quite a few more that deliver those services. Those actually people on the ground. Actually, we have more than 1,000 engineers, I think, on the latest count, more or less, give or take a few hundred. And they, you know, people on the ground are doing a very good job of actually delivering those sites to our customers. And this is cool, and it's how we've been operating, but this means that there are probably opportunities to deliver services globally. For instance, an example would be, let's get a company events. So whenever someone sells something, let's notify anywhere in the world. Let's notify our business analyst central guys, so they actually have a clearer picture of what's being sold and bought across the world. And that's not only on Mexico, but actually on across the globe. And this means that we have to find a way to deliver services that work on all the physical locations we have in the world. So we have all sorts of shops, if you like, which is we have stuff in cloud services, Amazon, et cetera. We have several physical locations across the world, and that's huge installations all over the place that we use. So that means that we have a pretty much, I wouldn't say any stack on earth, but you know, quite a few different shops, you know, people from South America, Europe, Asia, et cetera. One way to approach this would be, oh, this is Mesos thing is really cool, so let's use it. Let's build a Mesos cluster like this. Just one cluster with the zookeeper, et cetera, with all the locations. As much as we would like to for that to happen, it's probably not a good idea. Just to deliver one single big Mesos cluster in all these different heterogeneous locations with different hardware. It's not a problem that it's different hardware, but the distances and the latencies are pretty high, to say the least. And also have different locations that are quite remote, and the network topology is obviously working against that, as well as the speed of light that was from the previous talk. So we have a challenge there to say these local data centers, they operate very well. Actually, we have like, obviously, duplicated data centers and services, so as in one physical and one virtual in each country, things like that. But actually getting to coordinate them all together and say, I want to deploy a janitor service on all the sites in the world. This means that, for instance, we could deploy Chaos Monkey or something like that from Netflix to say that to ensure that we work on our resilience. Or maybe deploy across the world a security intrusion system. So to find out if there's intrusions, or like a janitor process, or an event, something that gathers events and send them to a centralized location for BI. That's a big challenge. And just saying deploying a Mesos cluster in 50 or 60 locations across the world is probably not going to work. So we were kind of thinking about this, and we were like, we should kind of go a bit more easy on it and say, we just need some way to deploy stuff globally across a number of dozens of data centers and locations, both virtual and physical. That is a bit more loose. But we really like the Mesos ecosystem and the frameworks we use in some of the locations, which already have deployed Mesos, et cetera. So what can we do about that? Can we come up with a solution? And before going into the solution itself, we were like, what do we have? What about from the stacks we use in production today, what are the tools we could use to accomplish that goal, to deploy something that is not necessarily consumer-facing, but it's useful to have all across the sites across the world. And we're thinking about the stuff we have experience on. We have Mesos already, which is, this is MesosCon. So we have some experience on that, and we have some stuff deployed in production in some of the sites, and actually we have frameworks in development, et cetera. So that's pretty cool. So we have experience on that. We also love Marathon as well, from the Cool Misphere guys. So maybe we could leverage that as well. And you guys, I'm pretty sure you know pretty well those two products. We also have Docker experience in production as well and some locations. And we think that Docker and the container technology would help us to say, I come up with a container that has some useful global service, and I can deploy it across the world. That's kind of a useful way to accomplish that. Probably will gonna work. And we have experience as well, and we're quite excited. I'm quite excited about the Fenzo library that was released yesterday by the Netflix guys, which is the scheduler of the scheduler library by Netflix, OSS. And I encourage you to learn about the Sharma stack from yesterday, which was very exciting. So we have experience in we have in production a few services that leverage, quite a few services that leverage Netflix OSS technologies. And we find, you know, to be a subset of them to be really, really useful for us, our services, really. So can we leverage that to fulfill that dream of deploying global services across the world in a comfortable way? And one way to one of the technologies we use in production we like from Netflix OSS, for those who don't know it, is Eureka, which it's, I would say, to simplify it. Obviously, there's lots of documentation on the site. To simplify it, it's a service discovery for the masses. We are production sites that use Eureka, which there are quite a few. It's quite good and works really well to do service discovery in a dynamic and very available way, which is pretty cool. And can we leverage that to accomplish that dream or to deliver global services? And actually, we found that Eureka has a version in development, which is Eureka number version 2, which is still in development, but it's quite stable from what we've seen, and has the goodies we need. So it's a kind of second iteration of service discovery that we know, which is quite friendly to having multiple locations. It has a structure, without going too much into detail, it has a layered structure of having like master write service and then lots of read service, so it can scale globally. And it really works well in, across multiple locations. And I'm sure it works really well for Netflix, and we think that it would be the version we need to deploy global services across several dozen locations. And it's an important thing is it's very partition friendly. It's a discovery service, both version number 1 and 2, which is geared towards AEP as opposed to consistency. So it really kind of works well with in conjunction with some other Netflix OSS tools. It works really well when there's partitions. And if we go back to the diagram, which is, say, this is the what we want, you know there will be partitions. Even the like short-lived ones, but the, you know, it's kind of obvious to expect that there'll be some partitions, and this is okay. And there's some other discovery service that are not geared towards that scenario. They're kind of more consistency heavy, which is fine. But in the case of Eureka, it really kind of helps out when there's partitions and things like that, and it's business as usual. So that's pretty cool. And yeah, you have to compile it now, but it's kind of seems to be working even if it's in the later stages of development. So I encourage you to try that and explore version 1 or version 2 if you have needs like that. And this, I was saying, as I mentioned before, this, for instance, this service discovery tool by Netflix OSS really works really well with other tools by them, which two of them in particular, Hystrix, which is a way to do microservices requests, so requests between services, in a way that's robust. So if, for instance, a service times out for a long time, then you may do policies to say, I'm not calling it anymore. And you don't have like snowball effects and things like that. So, and when you think that services are called globally, that kind of is to be expected, to be have some timeouts, et cetera, across the board. And this also ties with Ribbon by Netflix OSS. So a big shout out to them to releasing those tools because they're pretty cool, to be honest. And this is a client-side load balancer. So basically when services need to call other services, you can do all sorts of cool things to balance the load. One cool thing that is relevant to this talk, which is you can do data center or location affinity. So you can say, I will call the services that are in my physical location first because they're closer, but if none are available because they're down or for whatever reason, I can always call, have a policy to call a data center that is closer. A bit closer, it's not exactly in the on-premises as we are now, but a closer one. And in the case of having a global services that sit on the back end, you could say that if our data center in Spain fails, we can always call the service in England or London or wherever, following a set of rules we can define. And this is going to be probably working better than calling a random one, not calling anything, crashing, or calling one that is in the Philippines, which is a bit farther away. So that's a set of tools that does this job really well, and we have experience in production, as well as the Netflix guys, and there are actually many other users. So we believe that the consumption of those tools could help us to deliver global services to all these sites. So, yeah. On the other hand, we say this all this stuff is going to help us, but we're still missing something, which is, actually getting something on top of that. And when we were discussing how to leverage all that stuff to deliver global services across all dozens of locations, we kind of came up with a few principles, which is it would be really cool to build a framework from scratch. I would love to do it, but maybe it's too ambitious, and there's like lots of concurrency problems, et cetera, and we have to deal with, et cetera. So let's extend what works. Let's find something that works and do some extension, a companion or what have you, instead of just reinventing it. Because we'll come up with a unique thing that may not be the best implementation. So let's see if we can find something that works for us and extend it in a way that it makes sense. Another thing would be to formalize as much as possible. So for instance, you could say, yeah, this is very easy. I have 64 data centers across the world, virtual, physical, etc. Do a batch script that does a for each and just delivers everything. This can be done in an hour or less. But it's just a bunch of scripts. And then when we grow and we want to do updates and find out the statuses, etc., it's going to be more and more complex and be just a bunch of spaghetti scripts, which we don't want. So let's try to do a bit more formal on that. And that was kind of a principle we liked, because we all been there in the script spaghetti pasta bolognese world. I've been there quite a few times, so we wanted to avoid that as much as possible. And following and taking a page from the Netflix OSS book, we thought that having like wrappers or companions to systems that have no state, that are stateless, it's a good way to extend stuff. So having a companion to an application that just adds a bit more value to it or some features that it lacks, but has no state. It's just a piece of software that has some logic, things like that, and some configuration. And this is a good extension mechanism that is a bit underused, in my opinion, but we could leverage. So what we did was say, okay, let's apply those principles and build a tool that lets us allow deploy global services across the world in a way that is extended, it's formal. We don't have to develop a lot of stuff, and it kind of delivers what we want. And we just built an open source tool. We called it Triathlon, for lack of a better name. And what it is really is a high level wrapper of Marathon. So we have a Marathon, which I'm sure you're familiar with, which has a ton of features. It's really cool, and the framework we really like, and we have in production at some sites. So let's build a wrapper that just adds a bit more features to it. Hopefully stateless, so it will be more robust and so forth. And that's what we did. And when thinking about the design, we were like, let's not extend the API. So let's keep the API as it is and come up with a way to say, use the really cool API that the REST API that Marathon has to deliver stuff across multiple locations. And what it really does, in a sense, is a formalized way to distribute applications and tasks across different Mesos clusters that run Marathon. Which, you know, it's not a zillions of lines of code, but it's actually a pretty good paradigm, and we, yeah, the tests we've done are pretty cool. So the idea behind that as well is, on a global organization, you could have all sorts of situations where new locations come up. For instance, there could be a fire in our data center in Italy, which there was a few weeks ago. And you could come up with an emergency solution, have a standby data center in the cloud. It's a bit more expensive, maybe, but you can kind of offload load onto that. So, and you can have new development environments that people are creating all the time in the cloud, which you would still want to deploy, for instance, an intrusion detection system. Even if it's a development environment, having a cool little tool there that kind of finds out if there are any suspicious behaviors from the outside or attacks or things like that, it's also useful in development. So the idea is to say, if data centers come up and are created, I would like to know, and it would be just business as usual. I don't want to maintain a list of manual locations. Sounds a bit silly to say, you know, a new data center is built and you didn't know. Well, if it's built, I would know probably. But, you know, kind of development environments, cloud stuff, it's less of a hassle that not to take care of that and just have some way to automatically discover locations across the world. That's probably a good thing to do. And if one goes down, so one location goes down completely, it shouldn't be a problem. I put that little asterisk there because it hold that the center is down, it's probably a problem. But we're going towards a world where this is progressively less and less of a big problem. And this is kind of going in that direction. It shouldn't be a big problem. It should be just an issue, but it shouldn't be all hands on deck. And some of the big shops already have that, and we're kind of working on that as well. So you can have always like two different locations. One goes down, it shouldn't be a problem. So if that happens, and we just offload traffic to a new standby cloud service, for instance, we should be able to deploy tasks globally as well, immediately, without any phone calls. So that's the philosophy. I'll just give you kind of quickly through the architecture of the solution. Well, calling it a solution is a bit ambitious, of Triathlon, of the two. And it seems to be on the right track to solve these problems we mentioned, which is deploying services globally across dozens of physical and virtual locations. So the idea is I've only put two data centers. For instance, one would be a cloud provider and one would be on-premises. So it could be two or three or four or 20. And physical and virtual, it doesn't matter. So we have basically the kind of baseline hardware or cloud VMs. And then we have your run-of-the-mill Mesos cluster on top. And you have a Marathon, say you have a Marathon framework, which is required in this case. We have a companion application, a sidecar, that whenever a Marathon framework is registered, it notifies Eureka, which is the service discovery we mentioned. So whenever a Marathon framework comes up, the Eureka cluster knows about it. So, hey, this is a new Marathon location in Malaysia. Cool. And this is the name, et cetera. And this is the IP, etc., and whatever you need to access that particular Marathon instance. And this is kind of low. It's just a local installation, but with the particular detail that the Eureka instances across the world are connected in a big giant service discovery cluster. And as we said before, Eureka is quite friendly to partitions, and it's designed Eureka 2 to be able to do global service discovery. This means that the global Eureka network will have awareness of all the Marathon installations in the world. Well, not in the world, but in our little world. that works. So basically, you register your Marathon installation, and you have all your services as well. So you have all containers, applications, etc. And what we do on that, on top of that, is to say we have Triathlon instances, which are stateless. So they actually, you can run them from your laptop. You can run them on the Mesos clusters themselves, by Marathon, what have you. It's irrelevant. That they are, they basically keep in touch with Eureka. And whenever you want to deploy a task across the world, you just ask Triathlon to do it. And this, you know, in the end, it's just asking Triathlon, please deploy this task across the world with all the Marathon clusters we have. And it does it in a sensible way, and the thing just works, at least the first iteration. And the application itself is taken from a container repository, Docker registry, or whatever container repo you have. And having a few DNS entries of the static services, basically the Eureka two write servers and Triathlon, that's all you need. And it works. The thing is, one complex unsolved issue is the efficient or secure ways to, well, unsolved, not really, but efficient ways to basically have visibility across the global clusters. At our current solution, we have IPsec tunnels, but obviously some kind of SDN solution would be probably more optimal. But in the end, that's only needed if, well, it's actually needed for the Eureka coordination. But if you don't have calls across clusters, you don't really need for anything else. But we actually want to be able to cross, to have calls between services, between clusters across the world. Because if we have affinity, we'll basically use the local ones first, and if they are down or overloaded, we'll go to a neighbor. So that's like our architecture, which is, there aren't that many new things in it. It's just taking advantage of the tools we have and extending some of the ones we have as well in the case of Marathon. So what we, well, when we're looking at the basic problem, which is, okay, so I have this architecture. I have a task, which is a janitor process that kind of looks up open boards, unused stuff, et cetera, unused and underused instances, et cetera. I want to deploy it across the world. How are we going to do it? So what we did is to leverage the Marathon constraints API, which is, if for those who don't know it, it's a way to specify constraints or where to deploy tasks. And what we did is come up with a sensible default policy, which is really three nice words that work very well together, which is sensible, default, and policy, which is, this is the constraints policies of Marathon, which is unique cluster group by like and unlike. So we decided to leverage that. So I'll give you an example, which is unique. So you can say, deploy one task on each data center, so only uniquely, which mirrors the constraints in Marathon, which is deploy one task, for instance, in each host. Also, we have cluster, which is, in this case, is deploy all the tasks in this particular data center because of whatever reason. This is a slightly less useful because you would use the local Marathon instance to do that. But you know, you might do a canary testing. So you have a specific data center, you want to do a new release or deploy a new application. Let's do that. And let's implement that functionality in Triathlon. Thing is, it's we think it's useful to say this is a formal and it mirrors the API of Marathon. So let's implement the ones that we don't think are that useful, but we should still make it consistent. And a slightly more interesting is group by, which is you say, take that many tasks of this application and distribute them evenly across locations across the world. And in this case, it's discovered data centers. The system itself doesn't maintain, there's no manual list of locations. It's automatically discovered using Eureka 2. So as long as the Marathon's being brought up anywhere in our system, have the companion application that registers that Marathon to Eureka, Triathlon will know about it. So that's just, you can, you know, pretty much be assured that it will be deployed barring any partitions. So group by is deploying on all the data centers that I can access by network, which is usually all of them. And then there's like and unlike, which is pretty much similar to group by, which is using a rejects to say, oh, for instance, imagine I have one provider, and I have many data centers across, many locations across the world, or many zones, and many accounts, etc. I want to deploy a specific task for all those guys. So that makes a bit more sense as well. And this formality, you know, kind of going to the API and say, let's implement these features and mirror the Marathon existing constraints or policies or paradigms, it's quite useful. It's one way to say you have some of your job cut out for you. So that's pretty cool. It was a pretty cool strategy. So that's what it does. And now we will make our particular offering to Demogods, which is as I'm doing a couple of videos to show you a triathlon in action. And it's working, so if you download the code and stuff, you can get it to work. But it's just that it was safer this way. So the first demo would be deploying an application using group by to two specific clusters. And basically say, you know, deploy this app and do evenly across the two clusters. And it just works straight away. If we had four clusters, it would just do the same thing. So we have the same semantics. It was just kind of distributed evenly across them. So I have a little cool video. Hopefully you can see it. And I can risk full screen and see what happens. So yeah, so basically on the left, I have, hang on. So on the left, I have a Marathon cluster running on AWS and Amazon. And on the right, I have a different cluster, actually, on a Google Compute Engine. And they just have, in this case, they have running Eureka, the kind of worldwide Eureka cluster. So actually, there's quite physical, two different physical locations and virtual as well, from two quite different companies. And we have Triathlon deployed as well. Even though it's not strictly needed, but it's just, yeah, why not? And what we want to do here is the following. Yeah, we are so in the two locations, and we have Triathlon deployed as Marathon tasks. And what we want to do is just deploy a test application that using the normal JSON structure. So as we said, we found it useful to just change nothing about the API. And just have the semantics in there that say, deploy this quotes. It's a Hello World application that displays quotes from your favorite book or show. And basically say, group by data centers. And in this case, I have four instances, so it will basically deploy two on each. But there's no, this is kind of unmodified. It's basically from the perspective of the user, it's an unmodified API. And we do the usual curl. And we basically use the instance that's sitting in Google Compute Engine, because we can. And that works as expected. So it's kind of intuitive to say, this, okay, returns, it gives you all the input, and deploys the application on the both locations. And now it's really cool because it messes and Marathon will take care of that to continue running. So you've done your job, more or less, up to a point. And yeah, the speed is different for some reason, but it works. And just logging into to one and displaying a few quotes. And the funny thing about it is that we deployed it from Google Compute Engine, but now it's visible on Amazon, which is it's kind of cool. And there's some quite cool quotes from the book / show. I read the book first, the books. So, which, yeah, some people like more than the show, but it's amazing anyway. So that's one example. And I was quite reminded of that when we saw the demo from at the Windows and the Linux cluster mix. This is slightly, it's not the same, but it kind of goes in the same philosophy. I've got two completely separate technologies. that run on the base, but for me, it's irrelevant. I want to deploy this janitor across all the locations. And this is two, but it could be 50, no problem. And this is just for the sake of completeness, as I was saying before, it's the same with unique. It is slightly less useful, because it's rare to have one single application of anything in a cluster, but why not? And in this case, we built a bunch of scripts to do it. And you can easily picture this setup being run by some continuous deployment and some kind of manager, a top-level manager, to say, whenever there's a change in my app, do a commit, do all the tests, and then deploy it across the world. So you'll be able to use the tools you like. In this case, this JSON, it says, deploy two instances, unique data center, which means Triathlon will capture that call and go to each location and deploy only one instance. And in this case, it will do that. So we run the shell script and just deploys the application on each location. So we have two data centers, but it will just do the thing. But if we, all of a sudden, someone actually deployed a new location, it would deploy to the new one as well. So, and we're doing the same, basically. We're removing the app and doing, deploy four instances in two locations. It'll still do the same, which kind of mimics the philosophy, which the constraint says, I only want one instance because it's some, for whatever, legal requirements, or it's just an application that doesn't need HA, etc. So, that's what it does. And you have the cool quote from the book /show. And in this case, we did the other way around. So we launched it from Amazon, and we're accessing the Google Computer Engine instance, just because we can. I could do it from my laptop, but the demo gods haven't been kind to me lately. So this is an offering, so it's, you win. Here's the video. But anyway, if you download the code and stuff, it's basically what it does. So it's pretty cool. It's not a FX. Show me the code. So we have two things, actually, that we've just released this week. One is Mesoscope, which is it's at this location, which is at our account in github.com/shipstead. It's public, Apache 2. And it's a Mesos development environment. So it uses Docker, and it's quite user-friendly. It can be done using Vagrant, a Docker machine, plain Docker, etc. So if you guys can, there's a few similar options out there, but we kind of like this one. It's quite user-friendly, and we use it for development and testing. So, and you could basically deploy Triathlon on it. So it's a user-friendly Mesos development environment using Docker. So that's pretty cool. We like that. And the second one is Triathlon, which is the global marathon wrapper leveraging Eureka 2. So to deploy tasks globally across marathon locations, wherever they are in the world, it's still under development, but the code is there. And if you guys have any problems similar to ours, it would be super cool to work together on that. And some of the lessons we learned. So it was cool to think about one single message cluster across the world in 70 locations, but maybe not. And in this case, kind of the service discovery being AP-centric, availability and partition-friendly is very important for that kind of stuff. And we like Eureka too, so we need more services internally and probably externally that talk to Eureka. And if you guys haven't tried that service discovery tool, we encourage you to do it because it's pretty cool. And containers are good. So for instance, in the demo, but actually in practice as well. So we're deploying this demo application on a container on two completely separate cloud environments in a single stroke, if you like. This is possible to container technology. So we really like what containers bring to the table, what the Docker guys are doing, etc. And the lesson learned as well is be prepared to read code inside Marathon, inside Mesos, inside Eureka, because that's the status of things today. Next steps, add more calls. Now we have deploy, auto-scaling, container being inside Mesos. Networking is a big issue that we want to solve and improve, as I said before. And multi-tenancy. We have lots of sites, lots of users. So actually, sharing all this stuff in an efficient way is pretty cool and needed. And as usual, security, security, security. It's like developers, 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 but it's very important. So I really believe that. So thank you, guys, for your time. And this is the URLs of the two projects, if you guys want to check them out. Feel free to contact us, pull requests, or anything you like about those, because they're pretty cool. And anything else, just contact us. And we are to share that, because we're really excited about this kind of distributed global scale problems, which are in our day-to-day business. So yeah, any questions, guys? Yeah? Yeah. So the question is, one of the constraints we use is to basically distribute evenly the load across data centers. And do we have a need to actually scale up on a particular one? In the case of Triathlon, the aim is to deliver the global services. So usually when you need to scale up in that area is when locally you have a lot of load. So for instance, it's Christmas or some kind of local celebration in Malaysia, like the National Day or something. You will want to deploy to scale up the actual user-facing stuff. So in here, it's not something we have solved yet, but the first step is to concentrate on the global services, which are usually not that related to load at the national level, if you like. But it's definitely something that needs to be solved. But we're not seeing this to deploy the user-facing applications, because those are local or country level. So this is more towards like kind of more generic back-end corporate stuff, event analysis, intrusion detection, which doesn't really relate that much to scaling due to user activity. But yeah, definitely not completely solved at all. Anything else? Yeah? So the question is, does Triathlon, is it aware of actually clusters going down and then kind of doing something about it when it goes back up again? So the idea is to do a fire and forget. So I notify Marathon that this task needs to be run, and then it runs. Then it's up to the Marathon instance to keep track of that. So if the cluster goes down or is brought down by a user because it's a staging environment or whatever, this will be automatically deregistered from the Eureka cluster. So Triathlon will not spend any more time just calling it back again, because it's not accessible for whatever reason. If it goes back up again, then it will register itself again on Eureka, and now I can access it. So it's up to Marathon locally to kind of take care of the tasks, if you like, because it does it very well. But if clusters go up and down, or they're brought offline or online, this will automatically be made aware to Triathlon. So that it's solved in that kind of way, which is simple, and we believe in that kind of simplicity. But it's a very cool question. But it goes down, no problem. This is Triathlon knows about it, and it's just not there anymore. So you cannot really deploy anything on it. So anything else, guys? Yeah. So the question is, what kind of applications we plan to deploy? Yeah, the idea is to deploy the back-end facing stuff. For instance, janitors, Like processes that need to, we say, we come up with a policy that says we want to look at instances that are underutilized and bring them down and things like that. So a bit similar to Chaos Monkeys or Chaos Monkeys from Netflix. So that would be that kind of application we would see deployed. Also, for instance, intrusion detection. So if we have an application that does automatic intrusion detection, examining containers and the activity to find anomalies in it, that would be that kind of application. It doesn't really relate that much to the actual user-facing stuff. And other things would be, for instance, business events. So one thing is to do a local analytics, and the other is to say, I want to know all the goods that are being sold in the world right now from a kind of high-level business analysis perspective. So you get all the applications locally to send events to a kind of global bus. That would be the kind of app that we're thinking about, as opposed to the actual websites themselves, which we don't believe in kind of a very high-level centralized way to deploy that, because that's quite local. And we have teams in the ground that are doing an awesome job to take care of that. OK, so anything else? No? So thanks very much, guys, for your time. Thank you.